Okay, so I just wanted to tell you, probably to set up the stage for today's panel discussion as well. And I think there was one talk cancelled because, so that's why I am trying to fill some gap. By the way, this is the talk which I gave some time back, how not to work for Google or create a company like Google, you know. So essentially, that is a thing, right? How can you create such kind of companies? And so basically, I'll just give a brief. And what if you fail to create such a company, you know? So I think that I can just tell you towards the end. So of course, innovation is, you know, as the birth of living creatures at first are ill-shapen, so are all innovations which are birth of time. So this is a very famous quote by Francis Bacon. So I just want to talk about what is known as circle of innovation. And I think if you want to make, I mean, if in India, so the question why we are looking at this problem, if you look at Israel or if you look at US, tech-based startups are quite a lot. And what I feel, despite of so many, plans or schemes from the government, is still we do not have companies like Google or Facebook in India. So what are the challenges actually, you know? Why is, so what are the, you know, real challenges? So basically, if you look at what I call circle of innovation, in order to do great business, what I feel in most of the people want to create business, especially in Gujarat, but what is lacking, if you want to create technology-based startup, there are very few. Okay, so I think if you want to do that business, we need to do great science first, because science is the catalyst to technology, which will give you a utility. And if you can sell the utility, you will have business. And that business should again fuel back to the science. So this circle of innovation, so I think from the point of view of India, so we need to look at all these four angles if we really want to become just like US or, you know, Israel. So of course, why great science? Science is a catalyst, source of great ideas, power of imagination. And of course, in science, if you know what you are doing, you should not be doing it. That's an important thing by, important statement by Hemming. And how to get great ideas? On every week, I mean, I normally tell the students, on every weekend, you go to a library, read periodicals on everything, science, business, technology, history, etc. In fact, I can say that now maybe you can go to Videocan library, right? And this, read, because now reading whole, looking at the whole video is quite difficult, but you know, small portions you can always look at it, right? Something which you should do. So at least spend some time doing that. And of course, in the circle of innovation, we know that technology is the application. So what is engineering? Engineering is all about control of science for the benefit of mankind. And again, I want to quote, in engineering, if you do not know what you are doing, you should not be doing it actually. You see, so both are really important view, both for from Hemming. And business is opportunity. So if you know anything that won't sell, I don't want to invent. And sale is proof of utility. Utility is success, said by Thomas Alva Edison, when he was frustrated creating a few. when he created a electronic voting machine long time back, and I think which he could not sell. So of course, so if you look at science, technology, and business. So business is the third component. And so once you are able to sell, then you have a business. So then business again should fuse money back to the science. So this circle of innovation should be completed. And I think in India, this is broken circle actually. And what can be done? So probably in the panel discussion, we can actually talk about it. What are the challenges, maybe in our academic system or the universities, you know, or whether, in fact, if you look at from the point of view of even research grants, professors are getting mostly government grants, but industry grants are very less, you know. So I think those are the challenges, you know. So that circle is not working properly, even if, you know, it is there. And I think I have observed these following ingredients. For any innovation to become reality, we require a fertile ground, conducive environment, correct timing, belief in the field, and management team of people who share a passion for the subject, and determination as to succeed, which is really very, very important thing. I hope Manish has created a company, so having all these things right. They also tried some company long time ago in US back in 2002 related to mobile advertisement, but at the time mobile phones were not really quite popular. So basically we know that now there is a InMobi on working in the mobile advertisement platform. It started in 2007. So timing is very, very important, right? When you want to do something. So that's really very, very important thing. So what we feel that, you know, innovation has to be backed up by solid technical credentials, may not be degree, and interdisciplinary approaches, you know. This is something. And the fertile ground for startups can be created by creating solid technical people. And innovative spark, rest all will follow. And you can see, if you look at the history, most of the best entrepreneurs of the world are self-taught. Okay, so, so what kind of skills you require? Selling. So best utility creation will do the job, how to manage people, how to manage money, and of course you require domain skills. You know, for programming you should have written several thousands of lines of code to have that kind of skills, you know. So and of course for strong IT skills, I always say for computer science people, if you have not read this book, you don't know computer science, right? So this is something especially for the students. If you want to create something in IT-based startup. So I think how to solve a problem, I mean, you can look at this book by George Polya. Really, if there is a difficult problem, you can always solve some simpler problem and so on. This is the company which I was talking about, you know, InMobi. So Naveen was at IIT Kanpur when I was there, so I think I in fact asked him to come here, but unfortunately he was quite busy traveling, so he could not come. But it's really nice, smartphone-based startup. So I think in the area of smartphone, is still you know, the domain is quite good. Now I think briefly I'll just mention some of the new areas that are coming up in ICT or IT. Of course, especially I'm actually biased here, so I can skip some of the slides here. Before I, okay, so, so this new area, you know, which is coming, is about information processing in nature, and you know, it's a gold mine for science, technology, and business. And the question that was posed by Seth Colloid from MIT: how systems of all kind, computers, atoms, brain cells, societies, and the universe as a whole process information. So. Now I can show you some of the really good things. So this is the area that is coming up is natural computing, where you look at nature as inspiration. So you understand the nature from that point of view. Nature as computation. So some computation is going on here when these birds are bird flocking or even the ant computing. So, so you can see that so you can use some of these biological things to do computation actually. So this is a very nice computation done by fungus, you know. So this work is done in UK and there's a book also on this. Anyway, I think so I can ask you some very good question. If you look at biology, I can ask what is life? So of course, this famous book by Schrodinger. And I can ask how many life forms? There are about 1 trillion life forms. And out of them, how many plants are there? I think this is useful information. So there are about 31,128 useful plants are there. And out of that, you see, for different purposes, so for foods, medicines, fuel, materials. And I can ask another question, how many bacteria are there on this planet? If weight of one blue whale is about 140,000 kilogram, all the bacteria on the planet is equivalent to 50 million blue whales, you know. So actually each of you sitting here, each one of you has a unique bacterial signature of the ecosystem, and one can pick up those bacteria to identify you, you know. So that is a possibility. So basically, life and computations are related, and at the interface, great discoveries are there, you know, who can see. So basically, there is a lot of, I'll show you some news headlines rather than, yes. You see, the DNA computers have been designed to play this game of tic-tac-toe. Then there is an area of what is known as DNA origami. You can actually create great shapes. Paul Rotman actually back in 2005 he did this, and then finally 2006 this paper appeared in Nature. Here they he took the strand of DNA and folded into the desired shape. So again, you are controlling the nature. He developed what is known as counter, DNA origami counter. Then a box designed by DNA, which you can open and close based on the outside instructions. IBM was also working with Paul Rotman earlier, but I think there is less development yet. Back in 2009, they wanted to have a DNA chip kind of thing. Bacterial computers have been designed, so they can actually do a lot of computers. I mean, they can do pocket calculations and so on. We have human visual computing. We have ants, real ants, solving Tauber of Hanoi problem. So in fact, we have developed a software which can do any computation. So right now, it takes input of in the form of a circuit, and it will give you. So when they did the first experiment, they have taken about 10,000 real ants, and these ants have solved the Tauber of Hanoi problem. So basically, how you do it? You take the problem, and with respect to the problem, you design a a configuration, and put the ants at one side, and they will give you the solution path. Okay. So it's really nice. So we have the software ready, for doing these things. Then we have DNA sensors, DNA computers working in human cell. Then we have bacterial hard disk, 90 GB of data stored in one gram of bacteria. This is a long time ago. DNA robots, DNA circuits for calculating square root, DNA brain, okay. DNA writing. So this was done by Penguin at Harvard, and I think we have actually come up with the software. We automated the entire thing, what is known as DNA pen. So now you can actually, using our software, you can write things at the nanoscale. There is a 3D version of it. We have also implemented this. Then there is a programmable single cell mammalian biocomputer, so skin computing, Xyrem computing, Bi-Fi rather than Wi-Fi. And of course, DNA image processing. You can see that Mona Lisa thing created at the nanoscale. Okay. And of course, you can ask different kind of things. So basically, I just showed you. In fact, your thought is also a computational process. This is a nice book that you can look at it. So all these terms are quite related: natural information processing, natural computing, DNA computing, and so on. And there are some other terms which are used. Finally, I would like to close by a quote by Steve Jobs. I think the biggest innovation of the 20th century will be at the intersection of biology and technology. A new era is beginning, right? So a lot of, I just give you brief summary what kind of things are going on. So I think I will stop at this point. And if you have any questions, otherwise you can go to the next section.